Hi everyone out there in Google Plus land, and welcome to the Photoshop Show. We meet here every other week on Tuesday evenings at this time and talk Photoshop. And if you are interested in participating in a live chat room as well as watch the broadcast, you can go off of Google Plus to Keith Barrett's vidcastnetwork.com. Again, that's vidcastnetwork.com, all one big long word before the .com. And there is a new chat room, so you have to rejoin this time. We have a great lineup of guests and panelists tonight. The unbelievable, wonderful, superlative ALAN SHAPIRO is here with us. And did I say it right, or you call it Shapiro?
Tomato.
You Shapiro. Sound like the third graders who used to make fun of me, Jan, so keep it up. It's fun.
Listen, my name used to be Feldman. You think you got trouble. Okay, and we also have Keith Barrett and Nick Gaten and Patricia
Hello,
Robinson
everybody.
Stevenson. No, Davidson. Right? Say it again.
Davidson.
Davidson. See, I told you I wouldn't remember. And my co-host, Ron Clifford, and Sarra Robinson. So before we go any further, I would like those wonderful people to tell you a little bit about themselves, starting with our special guest, ALAN SHAPIRO.
Oh, there's nothing special to say about me. You can find me here, and when I'm not here, I'm working in New York City. I'm running an ad agency, but mainly I'm here, so yo.
Hey, do you have a website?
I do. It's alanshapirophotography.com. It's through Photo Shelter, so it's, I think, alanshapiro.photoshelter.com.
Terrific. Keith, tell us about you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Keith Barrett, and I am a photography enthusiast because I now have a camera.
And,
yeah.
Finally.
What did you get?
I have the new Sony NEX7 camera.
Oh, so, all right.
And I live stream Hangouts from Google Plus on vidcastnetwork.com, and you can find me all over the interwebs, plus keith.me, keithbarrett.com. And if you have any Hangouts you'd like to live stream, get in touch with me.
You have time?
Yeah, I can squeeze something. Yeah, I have my own show now, too. I have a Tech Plus show I do every Wednesday at 9 o'clock, okay. Too. So.
All right. Wednesday at 8 o'clock.
9 o'clock.
9 o'clock.
So if you like tech, Wednesday at 9 o'clock.
And Nick.
Hey, everybody. Nick Gatens. You can find me pretty much anywhere on the internet. Just type Nick Gatens into something, and I'll pop up, Facebook or that kind of thing. But I also have a website, nickgatens.com, but I do spend most of my time here on Google Plus now, so that's the best place to find me. And I'm a photographer and graphic designer.
So what kind of photography do you do?
I tend to do mostly macro stuff, predominantly, you know, nature-based. I kind of like to do a lot of hiking and that sort of thing, so that tends to be it. But I branch out, you know, go out and shoot architecture and that kind of thing, too, so.
So is the photography the reason to go outside, or is going outside the reason to do the photography?
The photography pretty much has been the reason to go outside. So I was the indoor kid growing up. So yeah, go outside now and do that, and then come back and sit in front of the computer some more. So
I love that. I love that about photography, that it takes you into worlds that you avoided all the rest of your life. Great. So, Patricia, tell us about you. I'm sorry to say I haven't met you yet, and I'm very excited to hear about
it. I just circled you today. I work at a community college. I'm the web administrator there. And when I'm not there, I'm with my camera, hanging out somewhere, hiking somewhere with my husband. And we go a lot, so I'm pretty much on the go all the time. When I'm not indoors, I'm outdoors.
Yeah. Are there some of your photos on the wall behind you?
Oh, yeah.
They're gorgeous.
Thanks.
Those are great. So you're a landscape photographer.
Mostly landscape nature photography, and that I enjoy the most.
Beautiful. And
just bought a new macro lens.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
For
macro's
which camera?
A wonderful world to be in.
Are you a Nikon person or a Canon person?
Canon.
Cool. Well, there's hope.
So, Ron, tell us about you.
Hi, I'm Ron Clifford. I do spend more than ample amounts of time on Google+. I'm a photographer, a community builder. I love nature, macro landscape work. If I'm not doing weddings and events, then I'm outdoors doing the other work. It's one or the other. Yeah, I love doing hangouts here with this show and with Life Through the Lens as well. And I've even helped Alan on his Photo Karma show as well, which you need to mention before the end of the show, Alan.
Of course.
Thank you, Ron.
And Ron is apparently not a Canon guy.
I've held one once.
I'm a Nikon person too. I can't help it. It's just,
You know what I think though, in all honesty, I have a Nikon because the first camera I bought was a Nikon, not because they're better or worse. And I've just stayed with the brand.
Yeah, I'm the same way. Same thing. All these old lenses, you know, I hate to waste them. Yeah. And would you tell us about yourself, Sarra?
Yeah, I'm Sarra Robinson, and I'm a stay-at-home mom. I almost never, ever close my Google Plus page. I am an entry-level photographer, I would say. I didn't start taking pictures seriously until last October. Mostly what I like to do are macros is what I'm learning, is what I really, really like the best, but I haven't even tried everything. So it's difficult to say what I really like and what I really don't like or whatever. I'm moving to Brazil in 6 weeks.
That's pretty cool.
And I really like to learn new things. So it's going to be a fun adventure, and I'm excited for the show. I use Canon for the same reason that Ron uses Nikon. The Canon was the first camera that I owned, a little point and shoot thing, and so I just kind of upgraded from there. And mostly now I just use my husband's camera. He got a 7D when he got his bachelor's degree, with a couple of lenses and a speed light and everything. So everything that I use is actually his.
That's okay.
So I just use what's available.
You'll just have to tell him he needs to upgrade and you get all his other stuff, right?
Yeah, there you go.
That's how my wife got all her equipment. I just upgraded and she ended up inheriting my other stuff, which is still, it's great. Yeah,
that's how it works.
So you're so lucky, because my boyfriend, I offered to split a wonderful camera with him. And it's like, no way. You can't have your paws on my camera.
Oh, man.
I know.
No. My husband is in grad school, and so he hasn't touched his camera since, you know, August. So he doesn't really get to say if I use it or don't. It's my choice.
Cool.
Well, I think it's important to keep it, you know, busy, keep the camera warmed up for him, you know.
Yeah, that's what I do. I keep it in good working condition.
That's right, yeah.
So great. Welcome to all of you, and thank you for taking the time to be with us, because it's really terrific to have panelists like you. I'm honored. And thank you, Ron, for rounding everybody up.
Thanks. Great. My pleasure.
So usually on the show, we start off with a technique, because people are really here to learn and see something. So I'm going to switch over to Photoshop. Give me just a second to screen share. And I'm going to use the new Photoshop CS6 public beta. You're probably, most of you probably still on an older version of Photoshop. Am I correct?
Yeah, I'm using a public beta as well right now, but I do have CS5.
Yep.
I just started downloading it a few minutes ago.
Wow.
I'm on 5.
You won't be disappointed, but the trouble is, once you've installed it and tried the new tools, you won't want,
Can you see my screen now?
No, I know what Ron was going to say, and that's the exact reason I don't download most of the betas, because I don't want to deal with having to turn it off.
That's right. I was just going to say that, but my dogs got too excited.
Speaking of supposedly, the new one's coming out in like within weeks, right, Ron? Isn't that what I heard?
I didn't hear that. Jen may know better, but I didn't hear exactly when it's coming out. So, and I don't want it to, because I don't want this little affair here to end with it. I don't want to part with my money.
We're not going to go there.
Okay.
That's actually something, you know, it's always secret, and that's part of the fun.
Yeah.
But you can, anybody can go to labs.adobe.com and download the Photoshop CS6 public beta. Public beta means that it's almost ready to be released, but not completely. So if you're using it and you find a bug on that same website, labs.adobe.com, there is a place that you can tell Adobe about the bug that you found, to help them. That's the whole purpose of having a public beta, not just for us to get to play with the new software.
Yeah.
Yeah. So can you guys see my screen okay?
Mm-hmm.
So what you're looking at here is Camera Raw, which is a plugin that comes with Photoshop. And because I'm using Photoshop CS6, the version of Camera Raw that I get with it is Camera Raw 7. But again, that's a beta. That isn't yet out. So if you're using Photoshop CS5, you'll have something like Camera Raw 6.7 or maybe a little earlier. But they all work the same way. And the way that I opened photos into Camera Raw just now is I did it from Bridge. I just selected a couple photos and double-clicked one, and they both opened into Camera Raw. Who knows why? I'm not going to tell you. Why didn't they just open into Photoshop?
Does Raw give you more? Because
you have that file extension associated with that program.
Exactly. You see, it takes a computer scientist to get this. So yeah. If you look way down
That's
at the bottom.
I was going to say.
Sorry. Right. If you look at the bottom of my screen, I don't know if you can read it, but this is a .dng file, which is a flavor of RAW file. I'm sure most of you shoot RAW. I totally recommend that you do so if you're not already, so that you end up with a digital negative that hasn't yet been compressed and sharpened and colored by your cameras, you know, inside your camera. So when you open a RAW file directly from Bridge, it automatically opens into the Camera Raw plugin, this interface that is separate from Photoshop itself. And if I go to the top of the interface and drag, you can see there's Photoshop behind, but this is Camera Raw. It's completely separate. And the beauty of Camera Raw is that it works a lot like Lightroom. Did any of you guys use Lightroom?
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, I just started using Lightroom.
So did I.
I can't imagine life without Lightroom anymore.
I'm with you, Ron.
It's not optional.
Well, one of the things people love about Lightroom, or two of the things, are number one, that it's intuitive to understand. Everything is done with sliders, and they're right in front of your face. You don't have to know the secret magic handshakes like you do with Photoshop. That's number one. And number two, you can just start at the top of the sliders in Lightroom and go down through them, and basically that's your workflow. The workflow is kind of sitting right in front of your face. And the same is true in Camera Raw, because in Photoshop 6 with Camera Raw 7, the sliders in the basic panel there in Camera Raw are exactly the same as the sliders, well, not exactly, but they're almost the same as the sliders in Lightroom. So if you've learned the Lightroom basic panel for developing your photos in the Develop module, you know Adobe Camera Raw. Nothing more to learn. Good? And you have your workflows sitting right in front of you. So let's see, I'm going to work with this photo, I think. I just like this one better. And what I'm going to do with this is use Camera Raw to make two exposures of this photo. This is a typical thing that I do all the time. I don't know about you, but I get the sky exposed okay, pretty well, but then the foreground is too dark. You understand why? Because, you know, the shutter will close down, or the shutter will speed up, or the aperture will close down because too much light is coming in from the sky, right, for the foreground. So when you have a photo like that and you didn't have the foresight to bracket, as I usually don't, what can you do? Well, you can create two separate exposures from one using Camera Raw. And then we're going to take this into Photoshop as something called a smart object, duplicate it there, and we'll have two separate exposures, and we can put them together with a layer mask. So it's kind of like bracketing after the fact. That's the technique I'm going to show. Make sense at all?
Totally.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. It'll make more sense when we see it.
Of course, it always does. That's why hands-on is so great and why, for me, books don't work that well. You know, I used to write books, and people just like have questions and questions and questions. Now I do videos. My videos are mostly on lynda.com, and I hardly get any questions. Like, people can see, and it really helps. So now that you're looking at this in Camera Raw, I'm not going to do this perfectly, but I'm going to do a few things to try to expose the sky. And as I do, I'm ignoring the truck completely. So let's say that I want to pull down the exposure just a bit. The exposure slider in Camera Raw and in Lightroom is for adjusting the midtones in the image. And you can see in the histogram at the top of this column that it's moving as I move the slider, because I'm changing the distribution of tones. And then, so I'll bring the exposure down to make the clouds a little more, a little darker. And maybe I'll increase the contrast. And I'm going to take that highlight slider and drag it way over to the left to try to bring back some detail in the highlights of the clouds. And another way to do that is to drag the clarity slider over to the right, because clarity brings in more mid-tone contrast. So where there is kind of mid-tone grays, they were getting more contrast. I think it's too dark, so I'm going to back off on the exposure a little. And, you know, there's a million ways to do this. It's totally subjective. There's no right answer. If I now go up to preview and I uncheck, this is where I started. This is where I am now regarding the sky. Better?
Yes.
From that, where everything is blown out.
That's a big, big difference.
Hell yeah, Jan. You go, girl.
Cool. So, you know, I love detail in clouds. I think that really is the greatest thing. That's so fun to take photos of clouds for, you know, they always look different. They're very intriguing. So now we've got some detail up there. I could get a little vibrance in, whatever I like. Now here is, we start with the real technique. I'm going to hold, see down here where it says open image. If I click that, that will open this as just an image into Photoshop, ready for me to work on it further there. But if I hold down the shift key, that button at the bottom right of my screen will change to say open object. So now watch what happens when I click that open object button. It switches over to Photoshop, and in just a minute, that photo opens here in Photoshop. And this is now no longer Camera Raw. We're out of Camera Raw. This is the brand new interface for Photoshop CS6, so it may not look familiar to everybody. The main thing you'll notice is it's darker than the interface for Photoshop CS5 and earlier.
Jan,
yes.
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
What is the difference between opening this as an object versus just opening it in Photoshop? Because they appear to have gone to the same place.
That is a great question, and I'm going to show you now.
Good.
If you look at the layers panel, it's a little hard to see on this photo, but there is a tiny square icon at the bottom of the layer thumbnail. And that means that this layer is a special kind of layer called a smart object layer. Smart object is an entirely new technology, and it's a little hard to understand just from, you know, listening to the explanation. But the general idea is that the actual photo is embedded inside of an envelope of sorts. And because the photo is in the envelope, you can do things to it like make it a lot smaller and then make it bigger again without messing up the pixels, without stretching the pixels and making it blurry as you would if this was a regular Photoshop layer. And there are many other things you can do because this is a smart object layer, one of which is the technique I'm going to show you here. And it doesn't sound like it's related to the explanation that a smart object is embedded in an envelope, but because it is, this technique works and it wouldn't otherwise. That's all I can say. So let's do it, and I think you'll see. So now what I want to do is, I'm not going to do anything to this in Photoshop except for duplicate this smart object layer. The big thing you don't want to do is how do you normally duplicate a layer? Who knows?
Drag it down to the layer, or Command J.
Exactly, Command J. But if I do Command J on this layer, it will make a second copy of this layer, of the whole image. However, anything I do to the first copy will automatically happen to the second copy as well. If I do Command J, or if I right click and choose duplicate layer, bad, I'm not going to do it, because then I'll get these two layers that are linked together. These are great, like if I were making buttons for a website and I wanted to style one button, have the style automatically apply to copies of the button, that's how you would do it with smart objects. So instead, I'm going to choose from the right-click menu on that layer, New Smart Object via Copy. It's a long phrase. I wish they called it something else. You could tell that engineers made these up, right? But if we choose New Smart Object via Copy, we do get a second layer that is an exact copy of the first. It's also a smart object, but it is not linked to the original layer in the way that I just described if you duplicated the layer. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does.
Okay, so now what I'm going to do is I have two layers, and I'm going to use the top layer for my sky and the bottom layer for my, well, actually, let's do it otherwise. I'm going to use the top layer and expose that for the truck, and we'll leave the bottom layer exposed for the sky as it currently is. So how can I start making adjustments to the truck on the top layer? Well, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to double-click right on the layer thumbnail on the top layer, and when I do, guess what's going to happen? Anybody guess?
It's going to open up the original.
Pretty close. That's right. It's going to open up in to Camera Raw. So when you double click a smart object layer, you have to click right on the thumbnail. That takes that layer back into Camera Raw for further adjustments. So even if I hadn't duplicated this layer, I still would have this wonderful capability of being able to come back in here to Camera Raw and change something. You know, so maybe I want to increase the exposure to make the truck lighter. Maybe increase the contrast. Yes?
Is this a feature for CS6, or is this available in CS5 too?
CS5, CS4.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah, it's been around for a while. A lot of people don't know about it, but there it is. And the reason... Pardon?
I didn't know about that.
Yeah, it's a
good thing. Well, there are a lot of things. There are a lot of hidden things in Photoshop, and that's kind of the problem with Photoshop. But now that you're watching, you know about this. So, anyway, I'm now going to adjust this for the foreground. I'm going to take that highlight slider even further to the left to bring back more details in the highlights in the truck, because that's my goal, to have the highlights be nice and bright, but show the detail in the highlights, not blow them out. I don't really have, oh, I do. I have some shadows I could open up down in the tires. So if I take the shadows slider and drag that to the right, it'll open up the tires. And I'll leave clarity over to the right. Maybe I'll increase vibrance. Now, everything I'm doing only with an eye to the truck. I think the clouds are now a little too blown out, but it doesn't matter because we already exposed for the clouds on the other layer. Make sense?
Yeah.
Okay, so now we're done exposing the truck on that second layer. Let's go back into Photoshop. And the way you do that this time is just click OK at the bottom of Camera Raw. That closes Camera Raw, and that top layer, the one that I'd open into Camera Raw, is now exposed for the truck. The truck is nice and bright. I'll make the top layer invisible for a moment by clicking the eye icon to remind you that's the layer, the bottom layer, that I exposed for the sky, and this is the top layer, the layer I exposed for the truck. Let me write those names in. I like naming layers. I'm really, I was going to say a bad word. I'm really obsessive about that. Okay, there we go.
You're really right. Organized that way.
Right. Well, there is a reason, because if you're, you know, like Nick, you say you're a graphic designer. I'm sure you have thousands of layers in your, not thousands, but yeah. Many, many layers in your files, right?
Yeah, and that's always an issue too. If you know, if you a lot of times when you're working in design, you get files from other people, and you have no idea what they've done if they don't name
don't
those
you
layers.
Hate that, Nick?
And also, you know, I'll go back to a file that I worked on a year ago, and I don't know what I did if I didn't name those layers. So.
Exactly.
You're one of them.
So I hope that you will name your layers, and there are new features for organizing layers in Photoshop CS6 that are really neat, by the way. If you do happen to get tons of layers and you can't even see one because they're, you know, going way down here at the bottom, you can search for layers by kind here. So you could search for like all type layers, by name, by any effects that you'd added to a layer, and so on. So you got to check that out. Isn't that cool?
I didn't know that, Jan.
Yeah, Alan, really you'll cool. love that feature.
Oh, yeah. My God.
Yeah, stick with me, Alan. That's great. That'll be great for you.
My whole week, Jan. You did it.
That's so great. You know, that's why I love to teach, because once in a while someone says that and I'm all happy.
Oh, my God.
That's exactly the kind of thing that I would download the beta, use every single day, and then when I don't buy CS6 right away, I'd be really frustrated that I can't use.
Well, good. I'm glad it's here. So anyway, now, what would you do if I told you, hey, I want to see the sky from the bottom layer, but the truck from the top layer? What would you do to make that happen?
I'd use a layer mask.
How did you know? That's exactly right. That's great. And it's good that people are starting to get layer masks, because I think they're the most powerful feature in Photoshop. So with the truck layer selected, the one that I've exposed for the truck, I will go down to the bottom of the layers panel, and there's an icon there I think I've mentioned before. It reminds me of a washing machine. It's a square with a circle. I'll click that icon, and that adds this white layer mask to the truck layer. It also set the new properties panel to masks, so that we have up here all kinds of controls for the mask. And that properties panel is context sensitive, so depending on what I have selected, I'll see different things in the properties panel. I like that a lot better than the way it used to be, was the adjustment panel would change, and then you couldn't get back to add another adjustment layer without knowing you could go back and all that. So we have a properties panel now. Anyway, that mask is currently doing nothing. As you know, when a mask is white, it is not affecting the layer to which it's attached. But if I were to paint with black or gray on that mask, it would hide part of the truck layer. So one way to add paint to that layer mask is with the gradient tool, which I'm going to select from the toolbar. I'll go up to the options bar for the gradient tool. I'm going to check that this first field is showing me a black gradient on the left and a white one on the right. And if it isn't, I would click on that field and choose the first thumbnail from the default thumbnails, the foreground to background thumbnail, which is based on, you know, the foreground to background colors. Mine are black and white. Now, I'm also going to check that first icon in the options bar to make sure that I'm using a linear gradient. There are other shapes of gradients, like circular gradients and such, but I just want a linear gradient for this technique. What I want to do is hide the sky without hiding the truck on the truck layer. So I'm going to start at the top, click, and drag down toward the truck, and it's just a crapshoot as to where to stop, which direction to drag that line, and how far to drag the line. But it's okay, because I can do it multiple times until I like the look. So let's say I drag down to here, to the middle of the truck, release my mouse. Did you see a difference in the sky?
Oh, yeah. It was dramatic, actually.
So if I make the layer mask hidden for a moment by shift-clicking on it, that's how it was. That's how it is. Now, perhaps, you know, you think I should have gone further or in a different direction. That's okay. I can do again, drag that line again as many times as I want. And every time I do, it kind of starts again. It doesn't, it's not cumulative. You know, it's as if I were drawing a new gradient. So let's say, let me see, this is how it was. I'll shift click. This is how it is. So let's say I kind of like that result. If you look at that layer mask thumbnail, I'll do that by option clicking, that's alt click on the PC on the layer mask thumbnail. Where the layer mask is black, it's hiding the truck. Where the layer mask is white, it's showing the truck, and in between, it's kind of gradually hiding or showing the truck. Make sense?
Yeah.
So let's go back. I'm going to option or alt click again on the layer mask icon so we can see the truck. Actually, I'm going to do that again. I want a more dramatic gradient, so I'm going to drag down like that. There we go. So now if we look at there, you can see that the top is hiding the clouds on the truck layer. The bottom, the white area, is showing the truck on the truck layer. And in between, there's a gradual transition of grays. Any questions about the layer mask part? Cool. Okay, so now if I want, I can fine tune that mask. Like I could say, I'm going to get my paintbrush and I'm going to switch to white as my foreground color. I'll just press X on my keyboard to do that. I'll come in and I'll drag over the top of the truck because I want to make that brighter. I don't want the truck to be hidden by the grays and the gradient. So you can always come back in and draw on your gradient or on your layer mask. And here you can see where I drew with the white just now, revealing more of the truck layer. I'll option click again. There we go. Okay, so I'm now done. I want to kind of show you before and afters. So if I make the layer mask hidden for a moment. There is the top layer that I created in Camera Raw, where I exposed it for the sky. If I turn the top layer off by clicking its eye icon, I'm sorry, I lied. Where I exposed for the truck, right?
Yeah.
You understand? Okay. If I turn the eye icon on the top layer off, there's the layer, the clouds layer, where I'd exposed for the clouds. And I did all of that in Camera Raw, adding the layer mask to the duplicated photo in Photoshop. At any time, if I want to change something, I can go back to Camera Raw. You know, so I could change something about that top layer by double-clicking its photo thumbnail again. That takes me back into Camera Raw, and you know, maybe I want exposure to be brighter or something on the truck, and say okay. So you can always go back and forth on either layer, which gives you the flexibility of editing, and it is non-destructive editing, meaning that you're not actually messing with your photo because everything you do in Camera Raw is just instructions. And that's it. Question. I heard somebody make a peep.
Jan, you could do this with as many different layers as you wanted, right? You could just keep going back to the smart object and copying, duplicating via copy, and then just playing with different aspects of the image, right?
Absolutely, and that would be a terrific thing. Do you do that with your birds, Alan?
Oh, God, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, also some of the portrait work I do, you know, I'll make 5 and 6 different exposures for different tonal ranges and then mask them together.
Beautiful. Yeah. And, you know, if you do it in Camera Raw, I think you get even more flexibility than if you do your adjustments in Photoshop. But some people prefer using adjustment layers in Photoshop. So that is the technique that I wanted to show tonight. And so I'm going to get out of screen sharing so we can go back and see some more stuff from other people.
I have a question.
Yeah.
When I upload my pictures from my camera onto my computer, they automatically open up into Lightroom. How do I get them into Camera Raw? Because usually when I want to edit something in Photoshop, I just right-click the image and I say edit in Photoshop, and it'll open it up in Photoshop.
You know, you ask a very complicated question, one that shouldn't be that complicated. And I can't...
Sorry. This is Adobe we're talking about here.
So actually, I just put together the outline for an entire course on that issue, which is how do you move from Lightroom to Photoshop, which is what you're kind of trying to do, or from Lightroom to the plugin, Adobe Camera Raw in Photoshop. And it's going to take a couple of hours of explanation in that course. Okay. So I think you're going to have to wait, or we'll try a little of it in another show one time, but it's definitely a long answer, so I'm going to skip it this time.
From just to make a note from, I don't have it open, but I just want to double, I was going to double check. Within Lightroom 3, when I wanted to open up a RAW file as a smart object, I did have a click Edit in Photoshop as Smart Object option.
You still do, Ron.
Yeah, okay. And that would open it in Camera Raw, but that option I don't think is there if it's not a RAW file.
Correct.
Yeah.
So I really recommend for the technique I showed you is do the... do the opening from Bridge rather than Lightroom, because it gets really squirrely when you open from Lightroom. There's a lot of param, you know, if this.
Yeah,
I do have a lot of issues going from Lightroom into Photoshop. Like, it doesn't render correctly, or it doesn't save. Like, any changes that I had made in Lightroom sometimes won't open up into Photoshop. It'll just open up the original raw image that I have to redo all of those changes that I had adjusted in Lightroom.
That's right. And that has to do with what kind of file you're starting with. So one thing you can do, Sarra, is you can export from Lightroom using the export feature. Export in whatever, you know, DNG or JPEG or original will get you the raw file. Stick it on your desktop and open it from there into Lightroom. That's the way. I mean, into Photoshop. Okay, so that is what I have to say. I see, let's see what the people in the chat room are saying. Nothing. Okay.
Let them, they're carrying on there.
They're grinning. Okay, so anyway, let's go and hear from Alan, because Alan actually does this stuff in real life, Alan, right?
I do. Tell us
about it.
Well, let's see. What do you mean I do this in real life? I mean, I'm an advertising chief creative officer, and I'm also an amateur photographer. And a while ago, I got a very large commission from the Ritz-Carlton Hotels that allowed me to sort of do photo illustrations, as I'll call them. And, you know, what happened is I was spending a lot of time at the Metropolitan Museum of Art. And for anyone who is in New York now, they have an amazing Renaissance portrait exhibit that just blows my mind. I've spent hours and hours there. And so the idea came to try and recreate these Renaissance masterpieces, aged and worn and cracked, using, in this case, bird images. So I'm going to show you how I do that in Photoshop. And that's it. Let me screen share and we'll get to it. Okay, can you see what I'm seeing?
Yes.
Okay, so I am open in Photoshop. I have a few images open already. Normally, like we were talking about, I start in Lightroom and I do most of my basic processing there. But just for time's sake, let me show you where I started. So here's an image that I shot at the Bronx Zoo a few weeks ago. It's a lovely bird, and this is the starting point. This is straight out of the camera, no adjustments, no nothing. And here is where we're going to end up. So hopefully you can see that there are, I don't know, in this case, there's probably 20 or 30 layers that I've worked with. And here's the process, going back to the beginning. Now, what I do is I have a huge collection of textures. So for instance, here's one. This is a cookie sheet, the bottom of a cookie sheet that's been color corrected and tweaked. I love my cookie sheets. And the first thing, and Jan, I know you've covered this, is how we get one layer into another image. So right now I've got an image here, and you can see that there's multiple layers over in my layer palette. I've got all of them shut off now, so we're looking at one layer.
Okay, Alan, can I just interject for a second before you carry on? Because I think there's an important thing to notice about what you're about to show us. And it's something I see with a lot of people that apply techniques, I think a lot of people don't recognize that you start with a great image to begin with. Textures aren't really a way to recover a lost image. I mean, they can be used that way. But I just wanted to point out that you're starting with a really great image to begin with. And it's not something to cover up anything, but it's actually an artistic expression.
Yeah. That's all. I mean, thanks for saying that. I do agree. I tend to see a lot of people who are trying to mask for bad images, and then what they get is just muddy, bad images.
Yeah.
In this case, for me, it started as a little bit of creative, like, relaxation therapy. I mean, just dragging and seeing what would happen. Also, I grew up as an illustrator before there were computers and before there was Photoshop. So, you know, playing with mixed media on top of each other was a very natural thing to do.
Yeah.
So, anyway, so to get a layer from one file to another, you simply click on the layer and drag up into the palette where the layers are, and then drag over to the file, and you see it switched over, and then drag back down. And in this case, you see they happen to be the same size file, and so I could fit it very easily. If they were different size files, I would just go in and free transform it. So pretty simple. The next thing I do is I look at how this layer is going to blend with the layer beneath it. And the way I do that is with the layer blending modes. Right now you see that this layer is here. And right now it's set to normal, which means you're seeing the layer as a solid object. But Photoshop has all of these wonderful blending modes that affect how the layer above blends with the layer below. And I'm not going to spend any time going into how it works, but I'm going to tell you that if you stay in the Move tool, which is the little plus at the top, V is the keyboard shortcut, and then hit your Shift key and the plus key, you will begin to cycle through. You see what's happening, and if you look, you probably can't see it. I'm just cycling through the different blend modes and seeing what it does to the image. Now, in this case, I happen to like what the overlay mode does. Again, here's before and after. And what I'm really doing now is just building up layers. So I'm adding a little bit of color. But as I'm looking at this image, I'm seeing that it's covering a little bit of the bird. It's blowing out the highlights more than I would like. So then the next thing I do is I add a layer mask. And the way you do that very simply is you go down to the little, the second or third icon with the hole in the middle and set a layer mask. And again, as Jen was saying, you've got white shows everything. And when you paint black, you start hiding. So I'm going to go and I'm going to hit B for my brush key. And then I'm going to make sure that my foreground color is set to black. You can do that with the little arrows over here. You can just simply hit X on your keyboard. And then I'm going to set a brush. Now, just a quick lesson, and I covered this in one of my shows also. The way you easily resize your brush is if you hold down the Control and the Alt Option key, the two furthest left keys on the bottom of your keyboard. And then if you drag left and right, you make it larger and smaller. So that's an easy trick. If you drag up and down, you'll see I'm changing the hardness of the brush. So I'm going from a very solid-edged brush here to a very softly feathered brush. Depending on the edge you're trying to create, you play with it. I'm going to stay with a very softly feathered brush. And I'm going to just start painting over. And if you notice, you see I'm painting over the bird's face. And what it's doing, because I'm masking the texture, is it's revealing the bird image below. So I'm going to do that very roughly because it really doesn't matter. The other thing that you can do is you can play with the opacity of the layer. So now that I've got the blending mode set and I've got it masked out, I may want it to be a little bit subtler than it is. So I'll go up in the opacity and I will start dragging. And you see what happens is, as I drag, I can, show or hide more. There are also keyboard shortcuts for that, but I don't want this to be keyboard shortcut overload. I'm going to get rid of that.
And hey, Alan.
Yeah.
When you blend out, so you've got your mask going on, and you decided you didn't like how it looked on your bird, so you fixed your bird, and
right.
Now you're playing with the opacity. Now, when I've done these layers before, the more times I go over an object, the more a mask will show or be hidden, depending on how many times I go over it. So, when you change your opacity, will that change that?
There's two issues that you just touched on. The first issue is the heaviness of the brush you're painting with.
Okay.
So right now, if you look, if you go up to the very top where each of the tool's main features is located, my opacity is at 100%. So that means okay. I'm painting with a solid brush, either black or white, in this case black. I can always paint with any tint of gray, either on a mask or with a color. And you do that simply by pressing one of the number keys on your keyboard. So if I want to paint with a 10% opacity, let me clear out this mask. And now I'm over here in the dark area. And now I'm going to paint with a 30% opacity brush. So I hit the 3 on my keyboard. And now I'm touching it, and it's much lighter. If I hit 0 for 100%, I'm gonna hide a lot more at the same time. Okay?
Okay.
Now we can look at that. I think, let's see, Jan just showed us. So here is painting with a 30% opacity brush, and it's additive. So you can keep going over it, and you can build up your gray scale mask,
okay,
or you can just paint solid. So that's the first step, Sarra.
Okay.
Then, once you've done that, if you still want it to be a little bit subtler in this case, then I would go and I would play with my opacity slider for the overall layer itself.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Thank you.
You know, can I interrupt a minute? There's another thing you can do, which is go up to that properties panel, and there's a density slider there. So when you have a mask selected, like the one Alan has, can you show him that, Alan? The density slider up there?
Yep, right here.
So here, that should make... Oh, it's because you have a...
I'm still hidden. So here is... So if you look at the layer mask thumbnail, as I'm sliding it, you see it's going from solid black. See where the layer thumbnail is down over here?
Yeah.
As I slide the density slider, the entire mask gets lighter overall relative to the overall layer. So anything that is very light to begin with will probably go to white. Anything that is black will get lighter.
Okay.
All right.
So if you forget to do it while you're painting, if you just paint with black, you can always vary the density of that black paint, turning it from black to gray with the density slider.
Right.
Okay. Good to know. Thank you.
Okay. So now I'm going to go and I'm going to show you. So here's the second layer. And again, I'm going to turn off the layer mask so you can see what I started with. It's some marble. What I like to do is I sort of go to kitchen and tile stores a lot, and I'll shoot in their back storerooms where they have slabs of marble and granite and whatever. Yeah. And then again, I'll just, you know, take it and colorize it.
Of course, they're convinced they're going to get this huge sale from you because you're taking pictures of all these pieces of marble.
Honest, officer, I just wanted to photograph the concrete.
Right. Yeah. So here is the normal mode, and I'm going to take it back down and, you know, let me quickly cycle through again, going back to V for the move tool and cycling through, and you see what happens. I mean, a lot of the blending modes don't work at this level, but when I get to overlay, you know, I'm starting to build up a nice additional texture. So here's before, here's after. So I'm getting a little bit more of the colors I want. And again, as I'm going through my texture catalog, I'm looking for colors that complement what I'm ultimately trying to get to. If I have a color scheme in mind, in other cases, I'm just experimenting. And I'll do some very quick sketches with a few layers just to see what happens to an image when I do that. Again, I added a layer mask because I didn't want to show the bird. And now here is, I'm going to speed up a little bit. Here's yet another layer, a totally different thing. Now, if you look at this mask, you'll see that it's primarily black. What I did here, and again, I'm just going to duplicate this by hitting Command J. I'm going to get rid of the layer. Hang on, my computer is now slowing down. So I'm going to get rid of that. So we have a choice of showing everything with a white mask or showing nothing with the black mask. Now, what I did here, when I go to overlay, is now I'm looking and I'm seeing that, you know, it's getting very dark around the corners, and I don't really like how it's getting just so dark. So at this stage of the game, I start with a black mask now, and I do that by hitting the Option or the Alt key when I hit the Add Layer Mask button, and now I've hidden that entire layer. And remember, I can easily hit the Shift key and click on the mask and hide it now so I can see the entire mask. So depending on whether you're working with a black mask or a white mask, you're either seeing it all or you're showing it all. And now, because I want to start revealing a little bit of that mask, I'm going to get my brush, B, and I'm going to now paint with white because I'm on a black mask. And I'm going to go up here and I'm going to start revealing things. Now, I'm being very coarse because, you know, this is, you know, a very quick show. But you'll see that I'm starting to just paint in here and there. And again, I'm always turning on and off to see, you know, I want a little bit of detail over here. So let me turn that off. And now I'll paint in and I'll start building up layers. Okay, so now we quickly go through. Now here, this was a really important layer because it starts adding a lot of the crumbling paint. So this is a dilapidated building that I found. And here, instead of an overlay mode, now I went to a screen mode. Now, screen takes only the lighter colors of an image and overlays them against the darker image. Is that correct, Jen? And the other thing...
I don't know, because it's so the algorithms are so complicated. Right. In general, what I say tell people is that screen will make your resulting image lighter than either of the ones you start with.
Yep. So here's the image. Here's what happens when I hit screen, so it did get lighter, and then I masked out most of it, and then here's yet another layer, and now I'm gonna get out of that whole thing, because then what I did is I saved my image and I went and I started building just to keep my file size down, because these are huge images, and I started adding more layers. So again, here on and off, and I keep going. You see, here's a layer where I started adding some scratches. Let me turn everything off. So there's a distressed layer. Now, I didn't want a lot of it, and you can tell from my layer mask, where is it, darker color, that I just used a little bit over here. You can see where the texture is showing through. This is sort of like wearing away the paint. And we can keep going, and then let's go to the final file. Here's everything turned on. So here we go. We're going to add yet another layer. This is just adding more distress. And now I wanted to bring in some blue tones. So I think I brought in something. Yeah. Now, the other thing to remember, it's not just layers, but at some point I decided that I wanted a little bit more brightness and contrast. So I just added an adjustment layer. The way you do that is going right up here where my cursor is. You've got all sorts of choices. Let me add a vibrance layer on top of that. So now, simply by playing with the sliders, you can see here's, if I take the vibrance all the way down, I get to a more muted image. And vibrance plays with the mid-tone colors, where saturation plays with overall color. So I'm much more a vibrance guy than a saturation guy. And then here I started adding a little bit of the cracks and the speckles. And so you see what starts to happen. And here is essentially the final image with, I don't know, probably about 25 layers when it's all said and done. And that's that.
Terrific. Questions?
Very cool.
Hey, can I show one other monochrome trick in Lightroom?
Oh, please. But,
yeah.
For like a 5 minutes. So I'm gonna switch out of here. I'm not gonna save any of this. Hi guys. And I am going to open up Lightroom. And I'm gonna go to this image. Can you see that image?
Beautiful.
Beautiful flower. Shot this morning in the garden. Here's where we're gonna get to. So just, this is going to be a simple monochrome processing trick. And again, I'm in Lightroom and I'm in Lightroom 4, but nothing I'm going to show you is unique to this process version. Now, Jan, as you were saying, Lightroom makes it very easy because starting with the basic panel, you know, they put things in the order they want you to play things with. You start with the basic panel, and then if you want, you can go in and play with the tone curves and so on and so forth. So the first thing most people would do is start playing with the temperature and the tint. But because I'm working in black and white, and again, everything I'm going to show you can be done multiple ways. This is just a real quickie. Because I could go down here to the HSL color and black and white panel, and I could create a custom black and white translation. But for me, I'm just going to quickly go right over to saturation. I'm going to take it all the way down to minus 100. Simple as that. I'm going to leave vibrance alone because it doesn't really do anything. And now I'm going to go up, and now I'm going to start playing with my temperature. So I'm going to take it the temperature down a little bit. And what it's doing, rather than adding coolness or warmth, it now, because I'm in black and white, it now lets me play with the monochrome values a little bit. So this is something that I discovered, and it just gives me a little bit more flexibility. So I'm playing with the sliders. You know,
that's
I didn't know that, Alan.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
That's
a great. And here now I'm going to take my tint all the way down. And again, you see what starts happening. Now, you know, what I encourage people to do is just start playing with the sliders and see what happens, because there's no right or wrong. It's really just, you know, personal preference and style. So here we are. Now I know, because I like images kind of dark and moody, and this one really feels like it. So I'm going to take my exposure down to about, I don't know, you know, here, give or take. Actually, I'm going to take it down to 9.5, minus 9.5. And my contrast, I'm going to take up a little bit. And all that's doing is it's pushing, it's giving me brighter brights and darker darks. But, and there's the second way of doing that is going down here, where in the new version of Lightroom 4, rather than recovery and fill light, they made it much more intuitive. So now we've got highlights and shadows and whites and blacks. So it's very easy to either look at a histogram and know what needs adapting, or just to play with specific things. So I know that I want my highlights to really show up a lot more. So I'm going to take it way up. And I'm going to leave my shadows alone because I'm kind of happy with them. I'm going to take my whites down. And I think I'm going to take my blacks up. So again, just playing. Now, I'm going to go down into my tone curve. I've got a custom curve, which is my sort of secret recipe that I'm not going to talk about. And then the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go and do some split toning. So now here, what Lightroom does is they give you a couple of color choices here. And what you can simply do, so did you see what I just did? I just clicked on this little color square. And it gives you a few presets. But simply by clicking on the eyedropper and dragging across and up and down anywhere in this color palette, you can sort of you can look and see what the different tones will do. Now I'm starting with the highlights, so that means I'm toning the highlight colors. And what I want to do is I'm going to get out of here because I know that I want it to be 52, so I was pretty close because that's my favorite color for a sepia tone. And for my saturation, I don't want it to be that saturated, so I'm going to go down to about 30. I'm going to leave my midpoint where it is, and now I'm going to go to shadows, and I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to go back to about 52, give or take. And then for my saturation, I'm going to go to 17. So you see what's happening. You know, just with a couple of quick tweaks of the sliders, now I've got a monochrome. The last thing I want to show you is you can easily go into your targeted brush adjustment. That's this, it looks like a long brush. And now you can take any of the controls below and you can modify them. So let's say, for instance, I want to brighten up the center of the flower a little bit. I'm going to go and I'm going to make a shadows adjustment. I've got a brush. Oops, I just shut that. I've got my brush tool. I can use the same, no, I can't use the same trick in Photoshop, which is something the Adobe guys have to fix. But if you look over here, there's a size and a feather slider down underneath. So I'm going to create a brush that is approximately the size that I want.
And you know, you should be able to do that, Alan. Try going over the gray part of your monitor and then try it. The right bracket and left bracket trick.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I can do the brackets. I was doing the control alt option trick, but you're right. I can do it with the brackets.
Yeah.
So anyway, so here I want to brighten up the center, and I can also, similar to what I do with the opacity in a brush, I can affect the flow, which is how light I can be, so I can gradually paint something in. Just to make a point, I'm going to dial the exposure way up so you can see that what you can do with any of these sliders. So once you set your brush in position, then you can paint, and then you can go back in and you can play with the sliders further. So ultimately I got to this image and I was happy, and that's all there is to it. So that's it for me.
Great. Yay.
That's so wonderful. Really. And, you know, I want to like reiterate what Ron said. I think so much of it has to do with your sense of design and color and beauty. You know, any of us can study the controls and learn how they work, but we can't all make something that looks like that. I want to be you.
I like it when Alan goes, oh, control shift P Q will fix this for you.
Yeah, just like that.
Well, you know, I mean, there's another thing that's really important. One keyboard shortcut a day. Just learn one a day.
Yeah.
And write it down and put it on a sticky on your monitor and do it. And so if you simply know that B is the brush key and the brackets are the two keys that control the size, use that for a day. You'll never forget it. And then go to another shortcut the next day. And I think, Jan, you pointed out the other day that simply by going into any of the menus in Photoshop and pulling down the menu, it will tell you the keyboard shortcut for that command. So if you're a designer and you're doing something repeatedly, probably behooves you, instead of going up into the menu, to come back and look at the keyboard shortcut, and then you can just do it in, you know, a fraction of the time. So
is there a list of shortcuts? Sorry. Is there a list of shortcuts somewhere? It seems like I've seen one somewhere.
Yeah, there is in Photoshop itself.
There's probably cheat sheets of shortcuts on the internet you can print.
I can't remember what menu it's under. I believe it's under preferences or something.
If you go to the edit menu, you can go down to keyboard shortcuts, yeah, and it'll open them all up. And then there is a feature there for printing them out as a kind of a Word documenty text file.
Right.
Are the shortcuts for
Google and just Google Photoshop keyboard shortcuts, and you'll get someone's cheat sheet that, you know.
Are the shortcuts for
a nice slick laminated one from a Scott Kelby seminar, so I'm lucky.
Are the shortcuts for Photoshop and Lightroom the same, or are they for the same functions?
Yeah, pretty much.
Some of them are different.
Are they?
Yeah, some of them are. But overall, some of them are the same.
So it seems to me a big part of what you did, Alan, is with the textures, bringing in color and texture with them. So I have a question, like, where do you get them, and how do you choose which ones? Because there's so many available. Or you do them, make them all yourself? What do you do?
Well, I mean, there are lots available. I found that, you know, I like to shoot my own because I'm a bit of a control freak. And again, it just gives me, you know, it gives me that much more freedom. If there are Flickr groups, there are DeviantArt groups, any of the creative communities that exist online, there are generous people who have put their textures out for people to use for private use. Again, because some of these are being used in commissions, I decided to shoot my own. What I am going to do, though, is I've got a huge library, and I was promising a couple of my friends, but I'm going to open it up. I'm in the process of gathering a bunch of textures, and I'm going to put them on my FTP site and just let everyone download them. So.
Oh, sweet.
You know what? I got to tell you, I was inspired from the first show that you did on Photo Karma. And so I've slowly been collecting. When I'm out and about, I just shoot textures more now. And I had somebody want me to show them in the mentorship program a little bit about doing textures. And because I had taken part in that first show with you, and I knew what I wanted to do, I had some pictures of spring snowdrops. I literally ran outside, clicked like three texture pictures from the pavement, came inside, and that afternoon did a whole texture lesson just with those layers. It was really cool.
That's it. That's what we do, right?
I ran outside. There's the sidewalk. There's the driveway.
Well, I got to say, everything that I know about Photoshop and layers and texturing and anything like that, I learned from Alan in that Photo Karma, which I sat down and I watched. I'm not kidding. Many, many times, right, yeah, in a row. I just like for an hour just watching it. Like, I think I've watched the first 20 minutes of it probably 30 times. Wow. Just to get it.
That's where you got all those hits. Yeah. That's wow. Terrific.
That's how you learn.
Yeah. So tell me more about shooting textures, like the one that was the tray. Do you put it on the floor, on the wall? Do you adjust the lighting in some way? What do you do?
I am such a natural light shooter. I mean, one of my greatest thing, I love working with flashes, but I'm not good at it. So it's a lot of trial and error, and which is why I think, you know, I'm much more inclined to work with flashlights and lighters and candles for my lighting when I'm doing special stuff than studio lights, even though I have them. But I will just go and I will take a couple of baking sheets and I will put them outside and I will shoot them. And then I will bring them in and I will play with them. And wow. No matter where I go, I mean, the other day I was just driving and I passed this abandoned nursery and there was like this long garage and every panel in the garage, you know, those multi-panel doors had peeling paint. So I shot like 100 different peeling paint textures. I was like a pig in shit. It was
perfect. I'll show you that. Sorry, I was just going to show you that picture that came together really quickly just in an afternoon because of the photo karma show that you first did.
Ooh.
Did that pop up? Nice. So that's just a really simple three texture layers of different concrete just right out my front door over the snowdrops, which were also right out my front door. So
yeah.
Just thought I'd show you how that was helpful to me.
Excellent.
Yay. So I have a million questions because I really want to know. So I noticed you had a high pass sharpening filter on the bird at the top. Do you always do high pass? Why? What's that about?
I do. I find that I have a little more control over what I do. I mean, obviously you can do anything. You can do Gaussian blurs, smart blurs. I mean, Photoshop is now, even with CS6, has enhanced their sharpening library even more so. For whatever reason, it became a habit for me to use a high pass filter. I think
you want to show that? Show people what that is?
Yeah, if we have time.
Keith, I know we're just a little over 1 hour, but we've got a few minutes.
Yeah, we're into overtime, but you know, we can do another 20 minutes, 15 minutes easily. So
yeah, let me just open that last file. It'll take
while you're opening that, I would put a plug in for high pass filter sharpening as well. I've tried many different methods and I find the best control for me comes from the high pass filter.
Yeah.
You know, I'll throw in that I heard Brian O'Neill Hughes, who's the product manager, one of them for Photoshop, say that the best sharpening tool, and this is unbelievable, is the sharpening tool, that it does the best sharpening of all the methods. And it used to be the worst, but they fixed it. And so if you do have a small area like the bird's eye here, give the sharpening tool a try.
Really?
That's what he said. He said, for some reason, you know, behind the scenes, it does the best job.
Okay.
Can
you see my screen?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, perfect. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to zoom way in, not that far in. And the way we do that is Command Plus, right, everybody?
Yeah.
Command Plus for Command Minus, and Command Zero takes it to actual size, but let's come way in. Now what you're going to see is I'm just on the bird layer now. I got rid of everything else, and I'm going to duplicate that wrong layer. Command J. In this case, I don't need a smart object because I am going to take this layer and I'm going to destroy it. There's a lot to be said for non-destructive working. I could set this up as a smart object and apply a smart filter, but Jan will cover that in another show.
Okay. So, I will.
Because smart filters, I mean, you know, really worth covering, I think. So now I'm going to go under filter, and now here we've got all the sharpening filters here, and even though high pass is a sharpening thing, a sharpening technique, it's not really a sharpening filter, so they put it somewhere else. It's down here in other. And you're gonna see something odd happen. It's going to turn my entire image gray, and I'm not gonna explain the algorithm. And you see that there's a radius slider, and you see that it gives you a preview window. So if I set it to zero, and I'm gonna zoom way in, now I'm gonna start playing with the radius. What I'm going for is I'm looking, and what it's doing is it's looking at the edges and it's amplifying the contrast. Again, forgive any of you, you know, technical Photoshop geeks, if I'm using the wrong language, don't go hating on me. It is giving me some further edge detail. And in this case, I'm going to take it up to about, I don't know, let's say 4. So you can see in the image itself, it's giving me a lot of sharpening, and I can look in the preview and I can zoom way in and I can, you know, really see what it's doing to my image. And I'm just going to click OK. And now for the high pass filter to work, it requires one of two layers. I guess you can use others. For me, I always use either an overlay mode, and here's what that looks like. So let me zoom in even closer. Actually, that's probably too close because you're never going to be that close. Here's before, here's after.
Ooh. So
look at the feather detail. Now, this is good, but it's sharpening everything. So I have a couple of choices. I can go back in and I can lower the radius. I can look at the soft light filter, which different from the overlay filter, is a little bit of a less aggressive application of the layer. So soft light is a gentler version of overlay. And then what we can always do is come in, and here I applied a mask. Now I know that the only thing I want to sharpen on this particular file is the bird's eye, because I'm going to follow Jan's lead, and maybe the feathers around her eye. This is a female, because you know the guys are all boring and dull.
I thought
so
it was
now, again, I'm going to go in with, because I've got a black mask, I need a white brush. And I'm going to start with, well, I'm going to go all the way to 100 just so you can see it. So now the mask is hidden. Now look, I've got my brush right over the bird's eye. I'm clicking a couple of times on the feathers. And so now what I'm doing, I'm also going to do the beak a little bit because I think the beak can use a little bit of sharpening. Here's before. Look at the eye, the highlight detail. Here's after. Before and after. Now we can do something just as an experiment. We can go in, and now we can apply a, let me do another command J. Let's go in and let's look at the sharpen filter. So Jan, what were you saying? Just use the sharpen filter itself?
No, the tool, the actual tool from the toolbox, which is over on the left.
So like just paint in with it?
Yeah.
So where is that? Here we go. So it's under the blur, sharpen, and smudge tool. And it lets me treat it like a brush. So I'm going to come in with a big soft brush. I'm going to make sure it's really hard. Look at that. So I'm going to do a, wow.
And it doesn't look all pixelated like it, yeah.
Yeah, sure does. Well, I'm overdoing it.
Yeah.
So here's before, here's after. Let me just do it again very subtly now. So just with a couple of passes, you get some nice sharpening there. So I think the issue is just using restraint when you're using that tool. For me, I would rather work on a mask because I can always just paint back and forth and be done with it.
And I notice, Alan, that you're doing your sharpening not on top of all the texture layers, just on top of the bird layer. And I think some people don't realize that it matters where the sharpening layer is, right?
Absolutely. I mean, you know, I'll do, you know, I think someone, one of the NAP guys who I really respect and want to give a shout out to, they talk about three aspects of sharpening. They talk about input sharpening, output sharpening, and then specific, you know, sort of creative sharpening. So the input sharpening I will do in Lightroom just to get it to a nice overall level of crispness that I want to start with. For output sharpening, that is based on what I'm outputting to. If I'm outputting to the screen for an online execution, I will sharpen a little bit more than if I'm outputting to my print lab. And then the creative sharpening is what we're doing here. So now if I were to go all the way up, let me get out of here. Oops. Well, doesn't matter. But what I did at the end of the image is I went in and get out of screen share. Okay, there we go. Are we out of screen share?
Yes.
Cool. I went in and I just applied an overall level of sharpening to the image because I wanted to pull some of the textures out that I'd created. So I'll do sharpening all the way through. It's just one of those things.
So I've got a question. You seem not only to be able to use this so wonderfully in your work, but you have this great grasp of what everything does. Like, and I don't see that everybody in the world has that. So my question is, how did you get that? Where did you get like the, oh, you know, the big balloon that encompasses all this information that you can pick and choose from these tools?
Well, you know, I'm, first of all, as I said in our last show, you were one of the people who taught me Photoshop. So I have to give props to you, Jan. You know, right from the beginning, seriously, I mean, it was your books. And because there wasn't, lynda.com wasn't around when I was learning Photoshop. I mean, I went back to, you know, PS version 1 or whatever it was initially called. I mean, I've been a Photoshop user forever. And all we had to do, and even, you know, Scott Kelby and you know, his wonderful crew, you know, there were, everyone was writing books, but it was really a lot of trial and error. And so it was just countless reading and talking to other people and sharing techniques and just playing with it. I, you know, it's just one of those things. Now, I'm fortunate in that as an advertising creative guy, I get to use it like Nick does as a designer when I'm, you know, developing layouts or storyboards or whatever. As a photographer, it's, I'm using a different part of it. So for me, Photoshop is like, you know, it's my left hand and I'm left-handed. I mean, it's an essential thing. And, you know, now Lightroom right there with it.
Excellent. So just, oh, me too, by the way, left-handed. Who, anybody else down there?
Yeah.
I'm lefty.
Yeah. That explains a lot. I don't know.
That's cool. Yeah. Well, it's wonderful. Wonderful to hear you. I enjoy your explanation. Nick, did you have something?
Oh, no, I was just going to say that's very much the same way I did. You know, we, a lot of it was... You know, we had books. We had the the classroom in a book, the Adobe books, and that's boring and kind of hard for a lot of people to go through. And you know, it's very regimented, and it tells you exactly what to do, but you don't learn anything other than exactly those steps. And a lot of it for me was just I would open a menu and click on something and see what happened on my screen. Yeah, and if I didn't like it, I would hit undo and try something different. So
yeah, that's the way to do it. And you know, it's amazing when you find out how many different things a tool can be used for that no one would have told you about otherwise.
Yeah.
You know, Bert Monroy is one of the great photo illustrators of our time. And you know, he was always very good at saying, you know, use the fibers tool to create hair and fabric and this and that. And, you know, he's just paying attention to all of the people who you respect and then passing it on, you know, that's
well, yeah. I can sit and learn about that stuff all day.
Plus, you guys make learning fun too. I mean, not just reading, it's more fun to watch you guys and see the excitement.
It is more fun to watch it live, ask questions as it goes. My own experience with Photoshop is it was really frustrating at first. I didn't really want to work in Photoshop because it was so frustrating. But once you get to a certain level, you understand some basic commands, you understand the basics of layer masks and what you've been demonstrating, it becomes a creative tool. You move away from the intimidating factor of this powerful program and start to really have fun.
Yeah.
And I really encourage people to stay with it long enough to get to that point. Because I don't think right at this point there's no other program like it.
Right. Yeah, I mean, you know, Lightroom Photoshop, that's it. And at this point I think there's a lot of people who are playing with a lot of the plugins that are available. And again, I'm a huge fan. I have Nick, Perfect Effects, and I've got the whole On1 creative suite. But I think they tend to get a little too carried away in the presets without first discovering what they do. So they're applying things without knowing why, which they're not learning anything. They're doing it, you know, they're applying someone else's creative ideas. They're not developing their own.
Yeah, that's very much like the filters in Photoshop itself. Some of the lens flares and some of those other things that I noticed when we were in school, a lot of people just, hey, that's cool. And they would just throw it on a photo without any consideration about any of those other details behind it.
Yeah.
So how are we doing on time?
I'm just about ready to wrap it up.
Okay.
All right. Good timing. Well, I want to thank you, everyone. Ron, did you have something else you wanted to say?
No, I think we got it all in. That was great. I think it's another one to go back and look at on Vidcast. By the way, to those who are watching, this show is recorded on vidcastnetwork.com. So when Keith does get it put up, usually within 24 hours, but it depends on his schedule, we'll post that. And you can go to vidcastnetwork.com and watch it as many times as you need to get whatever technique you were trying to learn.
And I noticed, Keith, you've been putting them on YouTube, haven't you?
I'm trying to start uploading my existing catalog of videos to the Vidcast Network YouTube channel. because the site that I'm currently using is making changes and they're not compatible with the way I want to do things for the future. So.
Well, I've been linking to your YouTube movies. So if you want to see a collection of all of these shows, if you go to, I think it's jkabili1 is my YouTube channel. I've linked to all of the uploads to YouTube that you've done, Keith, for this show.
Oh, cool. Thanks.
Yeah. We want to make it easy for people to find because there's great information here. And I really appreciate you recording it.
Yeah. Before we log off, I wanted to give Alan a chance to mention when is your photo karma is on when do you run that show?
We sort of took a little hiatus due to holidays and travel schedules and whatever, but it's every other Sunday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Okay. And I just have to work with Keith and get back on schedule. But the goal is to do tutorials like this just to show a given technique and be able to have people talk and ask questions and, you know, to sort of take the intimidation out of Photoshop and Lightroom and just share the wealth of knowledge that I've had the pleasure of gathering. So
great. Awesome.
Well, that's terrific. And you know, anytime you would like, you are always welcome to come back. Just give us a ping and, you know, we'll have you because you're the best explainer. Your work is wonderful and we like you.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. Okay, then. Let's wrap it up, and then we'll exit out of here, and then anybody wants to come back, we're going to do an after show where we talk more informally. That will not be recorded, but it will be broadcast so people can watch us.
Okay.
All right, well, thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
I'll be right back.
Thank you.